I'm a comedian. When people find out I'm a comedian, like in conversation, you know, like at a party, what do? I'm a comedian. Oh my God, that sounds so scary. I could never do that. And I'm like, aw, I am superior. You're supposed to feel powerful from it, right? You get on stage, you dominate, you kill them. Ever notice that's how we talk about success in comedy with this like, violent language. And it doesn't always work out that way. Lately I've been a little at sea with it. I don't know, like, I do my gigs, I tell my jokes, I get my laughs, or don't. And then afterwards I feel restless. I can't sleep. I don't know, it's kind of like I swallowed a whole walnut. Oh, I should be clear. I don't actually have any problems. I'm a middle-class white lady with a master's degree. My biggest problem is, why do people love me even more? An incident one night before a show. It wasn't stage fright, okay? I don't get stage fright. Sometimes I get stage concern. But this was different. It was like my heart started beating really fast and my hands started shaking. I don't know, somebody called it a panic attack, but that just seems way overblown. If I could just get some sleep, I'd be fine. It's not like I'm having a midlife crisis. Turning 40 was just a coincidence. I don't even know what I'm telling you. The point is, I'm in a slump. When I find myself having a conversation with my friend, Alexis. Alexis is an actor, and we're talking about dream roles, parts we'd love to play. And this is a nice conversation. We're eating ice cream, we're musing aloud, it's like that. And I happen to mention, you know, casually just throwing it out there, that I happen to think that I would make a wonderful Lady Macbeth. And Alexis says, you can't play Lady Macbeth. Friends, I took it personally. What do you mean I can't play Lady Macbeth? I can play Lady Macbeth. She's a badass. I'm a badass. I can totally play Lady Macbeth. Lady Macbeth is this sexy seductress. And? No, she's this evil, she's carnal. Oh, you don't think I can be carnal? Oh, I can be carnal. I was at a party once in 1998. Carnality happened, okay? It's not personal. Lady Macbeth is not your type. I'm hearing this. Of course she's my type. It is so obvious. What do we know about Lady Macbeth? She's evil. She's sexy. She's crazy. That's me. Megan. Lady Macbeth is a tragic figure of powerful darkness. And you are the human equivalent of a golden retriever. You don't think I can play Lady Macbeth? Nobody thinks you can play Lady Macbeth! Well, I am shocked! And you, of all people, my good friend, supposed to know me so well, can't see. This is what happens to women. Yeah, we get misconstrued. I blame the movies. I mean, don't even get me started on Cruella de Vil. Too late! Cruella de Vil is the hero of 101 Dalmatians. Little girl. woman. She has a clearly defined life goal. She wants a coat made from the skins of 101 Dalmatians. She doesn't kind of want a coat. She doesn't want world peace and a fur coat. She wants a fur coat made from puppies, as is her right. And oh, what, she's supposed to be so ugly with that hair that's half black, half white. That is punk rock fabulous. She is a bold, competent woman with a poorly conceived business strategy. Just like Lady Macbeth, Alexis. Oh, I can see it as plain as day. I can play Lady Macbeth. I mean, she is like my twin. Alexis, who's been listening to this diatribe with narrowed eyes, wipes the corners of her mouth with a napkin. Megan. Have you ever read the play Macbeth? Look. Just because I haven't read something doesn't mean I can't have opinions on it. Alexis wipes her fingers and flicks the napkin in the trash, and that's her way of telling me I lost the argument. I go home, and this is the insane part. I can't seem to let it go. Nobody thinks I could play Lady Macbeth. Nobody? What's wrong with people? Is it me? Is it because I'm blonde? Is it because my default resting face is chipper? I mean, I acknowledge that my personality doesn't overtly scream evil queen. But I have darkness in me. Well, I'm a woman in a society that hates women. Oh, well, that's not true. We don't hate women, we just don't like them very much. We don't trust them. We don't believe them when they tell us things. I'm wondering if you're gonna believe me telling you this now. There's a whole stack of studies that proves this. The wage gap's been well documented, but also more insidious things like when a man shouts, he's authoritative. When a woman shouts, she's abrasive. When a man asserts himself, he's a leader. When a woman asserts herself, she's bossy. When a man has a lot of sex, he's a stud. When a woman, well. But see, that's what makes Lady Macbeth so great. She makes sexism work for her. She's all raven hair and pouty lips. She's a femme fatale. She's Jessica Rabbit. She's Angelina Jolie in every movie she's ever made, except the depressing ones about war crimes. And yeah, she's a murderer. But so's Tony Soprano. So's Walter White from Breaking Bad. I mean, what's the difference between a villain and an anti-hero? Maybe the guy deserved to get murdered. Maybe he was a bad king. If the system's corrupt, is breaking the law really a crime? I'm just asking questions, I wasn't. She's so cool. Lady Macbeth and her thigh-high boots and her trench coat, smoking a cigarette. She's powerful. Me too. I mean, I don't wear thigh-high boots because they're not practical. How do you pull up your pants? The boots. And yeah, I've never, like, murdered anybody yet. But still, I know something about ambition. I'm a stand-up comedian. I've never been one to disappear to the choir. I mean, look at me. Do you see anybody else on the stage? Clearly I want to be in charge. So one day I happen to be walking downtown. I pass a bookstore, so, and I go in and I see it there on the shelf. So I figure, what the heck, take it home, check it out. Act 1, Scene 1, The Tragedy of Macbeth. Y'all, this play is crazy. If you've never read Macbeth, which, by the way, I can't believe you've never read Macbeth. The play is about a lord and his wife who together murder the King of Scotland so he could ascend the throne, only to be undone by their own guilt and paranoia. Everybody dies, it's very bloody and supernatural. It's like Game of Thrones, only fewer dragons. And Lady Macbeth is one of the iconic roles for women in Shakespeare, because she actually does stuff. You know, she doesn't sit around like, Ophelia. Why is Hamlet mad at me? She's understood to be this total boss. So it staggers me to discover she's barely in it. Her husband, Macbeth, has 690 speaking lines. Lady M has 252. Better be some amazing lines. She's not even in the play for the first four scenes. The play opens with the three witches, aka the Weird Sisters, which, savvy audience members will note, is also the name of the rock band from Harry Potter. Which came first? And the witches are all like, when do we three meet again? And thunder, lightning, or in rain? Let's go find Macbeth and screw with him. Yeah, let's do it. I brought my toad. Good job, girls. That's the whole first scene. Then some other stuff happens, and the witches are like, hey, Macbeth, we're old and scary. And Macbeth's like, is that a toad in your pocket? This toad is for medicinal purposes. Spare me your judgment. So then they tell him a prophecy, or he takes it as a prophecy, that he's gonna become king. So he invites the current king, Duncan, over to his castle and was like, well, I'll just drop a note to my wife. Let her know that you're coming. And that's when we finally meet her. She's reading the letter from her husband, right? And he's telling her all about the witches and the prophecy, and he calls her my dearest partner of greatness. See, he's not saying I'm gonna become king. He's saying we're going to be. Macbeth's a total feminist. And so to prepare herself, she says, the raven himself is hoarse, that croaks the fatal entrance of Duncan under my battlements. Come, you spirits that tend on mortal thoughts, unsex me here. Unsex me here. The first time I knew I was a woman, I was 11 years old studying tap at Charlene's dance studio. So growing up, I love all the old movie musicals, like Singing in the Rain and 42nd Street. I spent my whole childhood in a jauntily angled fedora. And we didn't have any money for lessons, but I hit sixth grade, mom gets a promotion, suddenly I'm flat ball changing in actual tap shoes. Me tap dancing at 11, my body's just the shuffling apparatus of beat. It's like a semi truck carrying a load of logs. And then the strap breaks. And the logs come tumbling down the hill. But now it's time to pick costumes for the recital. Charlene calls a special meeting, students and parents. We're to vote on which costume we like better, the blue one or the black one. She's take pictures of them on the mirror. They're underwear. Fishnets, cut to display curves at Hasn't occurred to me to worry about not having yet. And the parents are furious. They can't decide. They love them both. A debate breaks out. Sequins or fringe? Do we want our daughters to look like prostitutes from Vegas? Or do we want them to be classy, Moulin Rouge type prostitutes? I mean, I've seen those movie musicals. This is what the chorus girls wear. But somehow I never connected that's who I was supposed to be. I always cast myself in the fedora. You know, the speaking part. By 14, I begin pouring through the teen magazines, reading the cover to cover, the ads, the table of contents. There's an urgent quality to this. I understand now that knowing how many coats of mascara, the difference between lipstick and gloss, whether you're a pear or an apple, and how to dress for your shape. These are survival skills. And the more important the endeavor, the job interview, mock trial competition, homecoming, the more uncomfortable the underwear. Wires and compression fabrics wrapped in a sausage casing from toe to shoulder. This is what it means to be a woman. Smile for the camera, honey. Click. Okay. I'll play. And I find it can even be fun. Yeah, playing dress up. It's a little weird. Women should wear high heels because it's more important that a woman's legs appear longer than for her to have the ability to run. It makes sense if you don't think about it. I'll make it work for me. I'll be the prettiest. I'll be the most adorable. I'm doomed to fail. I got this to work with. No, I'll never be really, but I'll try. I'll try, and I'll try, and I'll try. So King Duncan comes to the castle, and everybody's all kiss, kiss, kiss. And Macbeth says, maybe I shouldn't do it. And Lady M's all, you can't back out now. Be a real man. Which, come on, Lady Macbeth. Don't shame him over his masculinity. The patriarchy makes prisoners of us all. It's the night of the murder. They make a big mess, but Lady M says, a little water clears us of this deed. Long story short, they get away with it. The other lords vote Macbeth in as king, which makes Lady M queen. Mischief managed. Except that's not the end of the play. Because Macbeth can't leave it alone. He's all paranoid. He thinks his best friend is going to betray him. So he hires some murderers. But he doesn't tell Lady M he's doing this. She goes, well, you're acting all twitchy. Is anything wrong? He says, don't you worry your pretty little head about it. What happened to dearest partner of greatness? He becomes king, she's out with the garbage? Like he could have become king without her. He was all hallucinating daggers and having second thoughts. And she is trying to make this work. She has spent her life surrounded by men, lesser men, murdering their way into glory. I mean, it's not like the history of Scotland at this point is all sunshine and democracy. She looked at these men and she said, well, I'm as good as them. Why not me? That's how I felt when I started doing stand-up. Why not me? I was 25, living in Chicago. Here's what I know about myself at 25. I'm funny. I can't prove it, but I know it. I'm funny, and I have great skin. Everybody tells me so. And I'm, too fat. too big or disproportionate somehow. I have friends whose femininity unlocks possibilities in their lives, but for me, this body is a drag. I have these hips and this moon pie face, and they are always in my way. I have something in me that I need to get out, and I suspect arrogance that other people will want to listen to me if I could just do it right. A joke is an elegant piece of rhetoric. Economical, surprising. Everybody wants to laugh. But you can hide a razor blade in the candy apple. You can smuggle all kinds of ideas inside a joke if you do it right. The first time I do stand-up, it's at a Northside bar called the Lion's Den. There's a metaphor. I know no one. I have no friends in the crowd. I sit alone at the bar drinking a Diet Coke. I'm the only woman. The other comics and I view each other as scans. They may not have seen a woman before. I do my best to be a good colleague. You know, laugh too loudly at the other comic's jokes. Courtesy laughs. No one's funny at an open mic. But I'm the only one doing it, so when I get on stage to tell my terrible jokes, I bring with me the only laugher in the place. It's death. It's a miracle I do it again, but after 4 months of silence, it may have been weeks, it feels like years, I get my first real laugh. I'm doing this bit about how Christina Aguilera is secretly a member of Mensa. But she's being forced to sell her body by evil Hollywood types, so she's sending cries for help through her songs. If you wanna be with me, baby, there's a price to pay. I'm a genius in a brothel. Getting a laugh on stage, it's like jumping out of an airplane without a parachute and discovering you have wings. It's all I want to do. I fall into a pattern. I go to my day job, then I go to my night job. Comedy happens in bars, and bars are full of drunk, leering men. I don't really like being looked at that way. Makes me nervous. Like my body has accidentally promised something I didn't intend. And can't control. The other comics, some of them will just boldly state that they hate women, that all women are liars, bitches, and why can't he get any of them to put out? And he liked to bend them over, these women, these evil women, just like bend them over and show them, and now here's Megan something. Try following that with your jokes about Star Trek. But I keep at it, like an idiot. It would be different if I had one friend who was a comedian. I can't seem to break into that fraternity. My other friends are poets, musicians. They drink wine and cock their heads. Why are you doing this exactly? They don't understand the appeal of nightly humiliation. Comedy show! Comedy show! Comedy show! It's one of those cold Chicago nights where the lake effect wind hunts you down and sticks his fingers in any gap he can find, up your skirt, down your collar. This is called paying dues. Comedy show? Comedy show? Hey, you want to see a comedy show?
Is it a strip show?
If I were in a strip show, it would be a comedy show. Comedy show? Comedy show! I hand my flyers to some girls who take them. Women will always take stuff they don't want, if you insist on it. Then I head back to the bar. The headliner is just coming out of the bathroom.
Okay, so, it's Joey, then Eddie, then me, right?
The producer says, and Megan!
You're not gonna talk about your period, are you?
No. Star Trek. The show starts. My timing's off. The crowd is ugly. It's hard to do comedy from a defensive crouch. The headliner gets up, and his first 20 minutes are just crude. And they're not even jokes. And the audience rewards him with these hyena barks. This is not my room. This is not my kingdom. When am I gonna figure out that they don't want me here? They want me to put on a dress and then take it off again. But first lose 10 pounds. I quit. I retreat into the writing. When you're behind a keyboard, nobody's measuring your waist to hip ratio. Fast forward. I'm 34, living in Iowa. Teaching theater to college kids, pardon me, adult learners. Academia is a quiet life. Lots of big ideas, no real risk. When my local theater company puts out a call for comic monologues, and I happen to have a real humdinger. It's a great story about embarrassing myself in front of a celebrity. I tell it at parties. So, you know, I type it up, send it in. The producer says, we love it. We want you to do it in the show. Oh, no, I can't perform it. I'm going to have a baby. The show's not till February. When are you gonna have this baby? February. It'll be fine. So, I end up getting on stage for the first time in a decade. 11 days after giving birth. From the neck down, everything is swollen. Imagine a Ziploc freezer bag filled with mashed potatoes, wearing stretch pants and a V-neck sweater. But you know, I get up there, I tell my funny story. People laugh. And I have wings. Maybe I could do it again. Comedy. I mean, now that I'm a grown-up. Maybe I could be myself now. Once I get started again, I can't seem to stop. I live in a college town that doesn't even have its own commercial airport, so clearly I'm not doing it for fame. But the Ziploc bag has freed me. I mean, nobody's looking at me that way anymore. Right? Comedy scenes tend to take on the personalities of their towns. In my small college town, our comics are young, nerdy types who talk about their penis. Then in the next town over, we have more factories, so you get more blue-collar comics who talk about their penis. Then in the capital city, you get your urban professionals who talk about their penis. There's a handful of women, but mostly it's just fields of penis. Which is like Field of Dreams, only different. It's fine. I like men. Men are just like regular people. I do pretty well in my small little pond. I do very well. And now, here I am, queen of my whole backyard. I should be happy with what I have. Do you know how many people would kill to trade places with me? I mean, dream job, loving family, house, car. My car has heated seats. Mine is the literal lap of luxury. How dare I ask for more? Oh, just like Lady Macbeth, she was mistress of Castle Dunsinane, and she had a whole castle already. If only she could have been content. Here's what I know about myself at 40. I'm smart. I may not be the funniest comic in the bar, but I'm the only one that's read Henri Bergson's treatise on laughter, so bring it. I'm goal-oriented. When I die, my tombstone will just say, tombstone, check. I know that the people who said I was too fat are buying into a narrow, capitalistic, Eurocentric beauty standard that is by design impossible to achieve. And anyway, I look great. Although sometimes I catch myself in the mirror performing surgery on my reflection. I still have excellent skin. Plus, I have cheekbones now. Gravity is really working for me. I know that the world is unkind to women over 40, so I'm gonna do something or say something. I gotta do it now, right now, yesterday even. There's a theory about women on stage. The suffragists used to stand on apple boxes and shout their arguments into the city square, make spectacles of themselves. And the theory goes that when a woman stands on stage and talks, that is a subversive act, an empowering act. You know, look at me, listen to me for a change. But there's a paradox. The act of standing on a stage invites the audience to objectify. Look at me. Look at this. So a woman on stage is both empowered and disempowered at the same time. Lady Macbeth. Reading this play was supposed to teach me that we have nothing in common. But I see myself in her more than ever. She's an agitated, ambitious woman, conscribed by her circumstances, however self-imposed they may be. She's a firecracker that doesn't have room to properly go off. I have these images of her stalking the halls at Castle Dunsinane.
As I understand it, she also had trouble sleeping. What do the witches think of Lady Macbeth? You know, they never meet. Isn't that odd? How the witches are always lurking around the edges of this play? Are they invisible? That's the prize you get when you reach menopause, an invisibility cloak. But the witches, they've turned that cloak into a force field, you know. Invisible, but disruptive. Macbeth finds them cavorting, being all devilish and supernatural. When he needed advice before, he used to go to his wife, but now, the witches. They show him apparitions of things to come, and he goes off to kill some more people. But where's Lady Macbeth during all this? She's left alone in the castle. Where she's having nightmares. She walks the halls, washing the invisible blood off her hands. The doctor and the servant listen in as her confession spills out. She just gives it all away. All the time with this non-stop washing her hands. I mean, clearly out of her mind. Out. Damn spot. Out, I say. One. Two. Why then, 'tis time to do it. Hell is murky. Shut up! Earth to Lady Macbeth! You can't tell people that! First rule of murder and comedy. Never admit weakness. Then look at her. The play ends bloody. Some guy cuts off Macbeth's head and parades it around, and we're supposed to see that as some kind of moral victory. But before all that, Macbeth is in the castle, barking orders, you know, preparing for the attack. When a woman screams, and a servant enters and says, "The queen, my lord, is dead." And Macbeth, he doesn't ask the obvious question. Someone comes in and says, "Your wife is dead." "What? How?" He knows what she did. She killed. Turned the dagger the other way, the ultimate submission. Is that my fate? Am I looking at a future where my only option, besides being objectified, is being erased? Because I really think I might be Lady Macbeth. But that's not the compliment that I thought it was. It's a death sentence. She's powerless. Does that mean that I? I gotta tell you about the panic attack. I get a call from a booker. There's a world famous comedian coming through town. TV, movies, on the best comedians ever list. Here's how famous he is. People over the age of 50 who don't follow comedy have heard of him. And they want me to open for them. Me.
my break. But he's a real deal. He's not some 10-cent road comic. He's not some 22-year-old frat boy prom king. He's not some denizen of the internet swamps who thinks it's edgy to use racial slurs. No, he is a real, honest-to-God comedian. A king. Coming to my house. This is my chance to really kill him. Okay. I'm ready. First order of business. I should probably work on my jokes. But I gotta decide what I'm gonna wear! I mean, this is a big gig. People really be looking at me. I don't wanna dress up too much, but I don't wanna dress too casual. I do a Google image search of this guy. Yeah. I don't wanna be wearing sequins when the headliner is wearing Crocs. I look in my closet. I don't have any clothes. I mean, other than my academia drag. This is a big gig. I can't do comedy dressed like Professor Buzzkill McFlunks-a-lot. See, what did I used to wear on stage? I wore thrift store dresses and combat boots. I don't want to look like I escaped a music video from 1995. I go to the mall. Nothing. Everything either looks like I need help buying beer, or else I'm going on a cruise to celebrate my hot flashes. 3 o'clock in the morning, I can't sleep. What do I wear? What do I wear? Do I wear a dress? Shoes? Skirt? Pants? What do other people wear? I do a Google image search for women comedians. Well, they either dress like they don't have a body, big suits, menswear, clothes they're drowning in, or else they're hypersexual, cocktail minis, sky-high stilettos. I don't see myself in any of those. Should be working on my material. Just don't blow it, Gogerty! Why am I so obsessed about this? I mean, you know, maybe I should just wear all black, you know? Just like, erase this. But then I'm so pale, will I just look like a floating head? Two white spider hands? And oh my God, it's the week of the show, it is just looming. I am having nightmares. Like, what is gonna happen when I go out there full on panic? This is why I'll never be successful, because with the chips around, I can't even, do you know what I mean? It's just, oh no, okay, you wanna dress in a way that communicates your comic persona, but who is that? Like, who am I, and what do I wear? And now it's the show. And I throw on something, it doesn't matter. Mostly black. And I get there, and they call my name. And now, here's Megan something. And I choke. Trip on my own knife. 20 minutes of a slow drip death. And no one to blame but myself. Afterwards, the headliner is very kind. He's been doing comedy for longer than I've been alive. He just rolled up to the theater minutes before I went on stage. He cranked out an hour like it was nothing. And then afterwards, he gives me some advice. He tells me which jokes of mine need better endings. He remembers my whole act. And then he says, your comic persona is, it's not a mask that you put on, it's you. boil down to your essence.
How do I know what my essence is?
Well, what do your friends say about you?
I have great skin.
Good luck, beer.
Evil, sexy, crazy. Exhibit A, crazy. Check. Exhibit B, sexy. After my panic attack and subsequent humiliating failure, I decide, well, you know, maybe I'm doing it wrong. Comedy. I sign up for sketch writing and improv class in Chicago, you know, the big city. I take a bus, I take a notebook. I decide I'm not gonna tell anybody I'm a professor. I don't want anybody to think I know anything. I get there, the other people in the class are all really young. The first day we're sitting around getting to know one another during break, and one of them says, let's guess how old everybody is. That's how young they are. Nobody plays that game over 25. And sure enough, 22, 21, 24, 20, 19. And now me, they're stumped. I have great skin. I also have a certain quality. They don't want to offend me by guessing too old, but they don't want to guess wrong either. Eventually, one of them hazards, I don't know, like 25, 26. I say, close, I'm 28. It was an impulse. I didn't plan it. I find out later this is actually the plot of some TV show that's on cable right now, like some woman pretends she's younger. I had no idea. I just got to that moment and knew the word 40 would be a splash of acid. It would disfigure me. I wouldn't be a person anymore. I'd be a 40. I'd be their mom. I don't want to be the mom. And they buy it. Oh my God, you don't look 28. You look younger. Oh my God, I am totally 28. But I don't feel a day over 27. They laugh and I'm in. I spend the next 3 days being pretend 28. I love being pretend 28. It's so much better than real 28 was. I spent real 28 being pretend 39. But pretend 28, oh, she didn't have any of the insecurities, but all of the experience. Pretend 28 is a teacher. She's a substitute teacher. She teaches sex ed to seventh graders. She could tell you some stories. Pretend 28 leaves her hand on your arm just a fraction too long. She's deeply invested in your story until you bore her. Then she flips her hair and stretches like she's a cat sunning herself on life's great balcony. They're writing sketches for me where I'm the vamp, the bombshell, the Marilyn. This has never happened to me. I get paired with the oldest a lot, 24. He's not unattractive. For a comedian. He's the airline pilot, I'm the stewardess. He's the boyfriend I bring home. He's the cowboy. He's not unattractive.
I mean, he's 24. He's a cable installer who grows magic mushrooms in his apartment. Last night at class, we all go out to celebrate. Pretend 28 is holding court, making everybody laugh. After a while, a few people peel off and 24 leans down. He's very tall and smells like cinnamon. And he whispers in my ear, "You know, I'd be hitting on you a lot harder if it weren't for that ring." Well, of course I didn't take off my wedding ring. I mean, why would I? I'm not cruising. I didn't come here for... But it's true, I didn't explicitly bring up my marriage. Well, it never came up in conversation. Plus, would pretend 28 be married? I couldn't decide. But he is leaning over me, and he is very direct. This has never happened to me. I could walk you to your hotel room. Would you like that? He's not unattractive. Why don't I say yes? I could say yes. It's not enough that I'm married to my best friend and it would break his heart. I am, and it would, but that's not enough of a reason. That's about him. This is about me. I could say yes. Why don't I say yes? This guy doesn't even know my last name. He thinks I'm a substitute teacher. I'm in a strange city. No one would ever know. My head is spinning. He smells like cinnamon. I'm not 28. I'm 40. I'm married and I have two kids. See? Here's the oldest. He's in second grade. And here's the youngest. Oh, is she cute? Oh, here's us on vacation. We rented paddle boats. It's just that he so clearly desired me. See, men desire and women are a thing that is desired, and I have rejected that binary my entire life. One, because it's heteronormative. Two, because I want to be the thing on the shelf. I want to be the one that does things. But I never knew that being the thing that is desired could feel so yummy. And I wasn't even trying. I was in my regulation hoodie, my glasses. Am I enough? Why have I avoided this feeling for so long? Oh, Lady Macbeth is a sexy seductress, and you're a golden retriever. I'm a golden retriever who knows how to catch a bone. Give it to me. The hole. She's desired and she wants things for herself. That which hath made them drunk hath
made me bold. What hath quenched them hath given me fire. Of course, she's punished for it. We always punish the women for wanting things. See, women are supposed to crab walk toward their goals. Oh, no, darling, no, nothing for me, thank you. I simply exist for the pleasure of serving you. If I were to be so fortunate as to earn your respect, or land this job, or win this election, and if she does get it, she's supposed to act like the outcome were a surprise party, not something that she worked for. All this for me? You shouldn't have. I don't recognize myself. I'm out late. I'm drinking. I think inside, the panic attack is still going on. I get home. I go to an open mic two towns over, pick a table, order a drink. There's a comic on stage telling a joke about how they should change Shark Week to Vagina Week. Because like sharks, vaginas come from below, smell like fish, and to get away from them, you punch them in the eye. And I experienced a weird mix of feelings. My first thought, that's actually a joke. You know, it's not a good joke, but he's not just mindlessly spewing misogyny either. He's worked on this. My second thought, vaginas don't have eyes. What's he think we got down there? My third thought, if I heard this joke in my 20s, I would have turned around and never come back. Why put up with it? But I'm not in my 20s anymore. My body is my own, not a collection of parts to be appraised by some funyun-eating dill hole. I get on that stage and I beat them down. I go supernova, just pummeling them with energy until their eyes melt out of their faces. I burn their villages and raise their farmlands. I dominate, I decimate, I destroy. I kill them. And I step off that stage a mighty warrior in her armor, untouchable, when the host of the club, some little skid mark, comes up to me and afterwards carries on a whole conversation with my breasts. Hey girl, you did good tonight. You wanna keep doing good? You want a slot in the show next week? I bet you got a nice slot. See, I always thought that it was me. That if I was funny enough or clever enough or
or savvy enough, or if I weighed less, or if I had better clothes or different clothes, that the flaw was in me, that there was something that I could do, but there is actually nothing I can do. There is no possible action I can take to stop it. Every woman in this room knows what it's like to walk in the dark with your antenna up, to grow eyes on the back of your head, to never leave your drink unattended lest someone try to poison you, to live under threat. Dare they do that to us? Make us live like that. Lady Macbeth is so sexy. But so what? It doesn't help her. Macbeth becomes king and almost immediately cuts her out. She is gone from his inner circle, from the play itself. Evil, sexy, crazy, sexy is the only good one. And it gets her nothing. No wonder she goes crazy. To know what you are capable of. Only to be denied, reduced, shut out for stupid reasons? Sexy! Why don't more women murder? Which brings me to exhibit C. Evil. I'm at the bar with some comics. I'm at the bar a lot. I'm just trying to break in with this gang. There's a jocularity starting to emerge. I know them, they know me. Enough. One of them's putting together a showcase for new comics. Hey, Gogerty, what do you think of Vanessa? Think she's ready to showcase? Vanessa. She's new. You're not very funny. Nobody's funny when they're new. But still, she irritates me. And why are they asking me? I don't know Vanessa. Is it because I'm a woman? I'm supposed to be the expert on all other women comedians? I'm feeling sparky. You know, the hungry place where the laughs get mean. Where nothing matters but the zinger. Where is it written that I have to like everybody? I'm not the comedy camp counselor. What do I think of Vanessa? I think if she's gonna be that unoriginal, she's gonna need bigger tits. Oh! Burn, Gogerty! The bar erupts. Literal pats on the back. I'm one of them now. I've joined the fraternity. Only cost me a human sacrifice. I'm on a bender. Open mic. Showcase. Open mic. Always the only woman. Hey, whatever happened to Vanessa? Nobody knows. Doesn't she want to do comedy anymore? Guess not. I guess she couldn't take it. Maybe she needs to grow a thicker skin. Hey, don't be mad at me. I'm a bold, competent woman with a poorly conceived business strategy. And I'm drunk. I go out to my car without a coat. Get in the front seat. I am skidding out on an oil slick of my own self-loathing. I can't seem to get any traction. Am I doing this to myself? Or is it being done to me? This is a nice car. It's big. This car could be a weapon. I left my keys in my coat. My coat made of puppies! I go back to the bar to get my coat. The show's still going on, but they've added some new comics, some late arrivals. Bethany and Hannah. Those are women's names. Three women at the open mic? I watch their sets while I sober up with a Diet Coke. Three women at the open mic? I can't get over it. That's like a record. Something happens. The fog lifts. See, when there's two women at the open mic, it's like Thunderdome. There can be only one, but when there's three, we transform back into people again. Maybe three's the magic number. Back to back to back, we could see them coming in from all directions. Three's a coven. Round about the cauldron go, in the poison entrails throw. Told that under cold stone, days and nights have 31 sweltered venom sleeping about. Boiled out first in the charming pot. Double, double, toil and trouble. Fire burn and cauldron bubble! Here's what we know about the witches. They're wicked. We know this because they're ugly. They got chapped lips and beards. Plus they do all these gruesome spells with like body parts in them. But what kind of witch are they? Maybe they're Wiccan, I don't know. I don't think I could be a Wiccan because I don't like to go outside. That kind of seems like it's part of it. The witches. They've been in this play from the very beginning. It's weird. The witches are the only ones having any fun. Comedy is supposed to be fun. I get a call from a booker. He says, we want to do a comedy show Saturday afternoon in a furniture store. I say, that sounds terrible. I'll do it. I mean, why not, right? 40-something comedian in Iowa. At least it's novel. I get there, and it's this like high-end, fancy place. They have chandeliers, $6,000 sofas. It's like the Vegas of furniture stores. And sure enough, I'm the only comic. They call my name, I screw my courage to the sticking place. And wouldn't you know it, there's a crowd. They got like 25 people here, which for a furniture store is amazing. And this is sunlight streaming through the window. All these people reclining on this plush, fine furniture. Sober as a parole board. And there's a horrible silence. And I feel it brewing in me. The panic. It's the thing that I know to be true, that I have been shoving away with both hands. I can't make them laugh. I can't make them like me. I can't make them do anything.
I have to make myself.
I have to love them.
I have to love them so hard. I have to love them enough to tell them the truth. I have to love them until they're no longer afraid, because audiences are so afraid. I have to tell them it's okay. I got you. I'm not gonna let you down. In that furniture store, on that Saturday afternoon, I make magic. I have fun. And they have fun. And everybody has wings. Comedy is not about killing. It's about taking a group of individuals and turning them into a crowd. It's about stoking that crowd into waves of ecstasy. It is the act of creation in the room. Comedy is sex! But not the fishnet kind. In the way of the crones dancing naked around the maypole, in the way of the seasons and the solstice. I don't have to be Lady Macbeth! That could be. I recognize her pain in me, but I have another option. What saves me from her fate is Lady Macbeth can't make a joke. Hey, Alexis, I think I'm a witch. Obviously. You think I need you to tell me my best friend is magical? I could have told you that, you stupid idiot. Alexis insults people when she loves them. I make them characters in my plays. Friendship. Poor Lady Macbeth. She's trapped in that terrible story. She's all alone. She doesn't even have a friend. Yes, she does. She has me. I can be her best friend, her gal pal. I have magical powers. I can help her. I can rewrite the play. Let's say she gets the letter from her husband telling her about the witches and the prophecy. Let's say she doesn't call down the spirits that tend on mortal thoughts. Let's say she goes out. Why corrupt my husband? And they would cackle and say, we simply expose the truth. You think that hard little walnut you've swallowed that scrapes your insides, you think that could be eased by being crowned a queen? You're like a starving person gnawing on rocks. That kernel, that hunger is the life force. That is our call. Tell me what to do.
You have already done it. You have left the castle never to return. You will join us in the circle. We will teach you the mysteries. Clutch hands and fly! And then you will know true freedom.
A joke is a kind of magic. If Lady Macbeth could make a joke, maybe then she'd have a first name. She could go to a Scottish open mic. Put your hands together for Connie Macbeth! And then she would go, my husband, the king, is so tyrannical. If he were a dinosaur, he would be a Tyrannosaurus Rex. Nobody's funny at an open mic. There's a superstition that if you say the name of the Scottish play in a theater, you'll be cursed. I don't believe it. That idea implies that evil is outside of you. Which, please. However, we have called her forth. And she's a famously discontented woman. And she's been so misused. She deserves, if not forgiveness, then respect. Love. We need three. I'm one, she's the second. You're the third. Welcome to the coven. Let's see. There we go. We'll do this. Spread that out. Yeah, here. It's kind of. We'll see, just kind of making this up. Goddess of comedy! Because obviously you're a woman. You know, I need a wand. Goddess of comedy! Release our friend, Connie Macbeth! She was gonna keep her maiden name, but her husband wanted to go into politics. She killed herself. Goddess. Whether she was defeated by the world or she sabotaged herself. Either way, she thought it was her only option, and maybe it was. But Goddess, I would like to believe that there exists a place in your bosom, a space in our collective imagination where she lives on. A place where she can grow old and laugh and not be held hostage by the violent hierarchies of kings and queens. She could tell jokes and walk in the woods and find peace.
Maybe it's in upstate New York.
Empower her, Goddess! And by empowering her, you embolden us all, for we are still here, walking this earth, and we are all Connie Macbeth, and they want us to buy in to their hoodwink. But Goddess, you can teach us to play our own games, and not the ones they set for us. You can give us magic. I carry this feeling in my heart. I wish you jokes and sex, the good kind. May the truth set us free.